It's like a loop machine. Going around town, trying to get down. It's like a loop machine.
Good afternoon and welcome to the BCSN Game Time Show.
Takes a snap, hand ice, keeper throws far side catch, made breaking tackles, getting up to the 35-yard line.
Soto tips it this time. Here's Bayline with the setup. This is going to be a tough one. Got to get it over. They do. FMU does. Southeastern over the middle. Tipped. Saved. Another block there by Southeastern. Again, Adriana Soto.
All in the hands of TJ Jones. Right down the middle of the lane. Off the
and he gets it.
TJ Jones makes that. And we had a quick timeout.
Yes.
We'll see what happens. Williams has it. Are going to foul him? Oh, he kicked out his foot. He lost the ball. And that's going to do it. Xavier, the Bold Rush. The Bold Rush, the champion of the GCAC. Final score. Xavier, 78. Tougaloo, 75. An unbelievable finish to this ball game. The first GCAC tournament championship since 1996.
We'll give you first up to just talk about what took place in that meeting before we get in some additional questions in regards to the decisions deciding to postpone the Slack Fall season.
And our new number one is Howard University with a record of 5-2. Thoughts, Drew, or any thoughts on the, or any comments, I guess, on the numbers as you saw them in our
form? Howard's on the roll.
Thank you guys for what you do for HBCU athletics. This is a fantastic avenue for all of us. This is our ESPN, so we love what you guys do, Brian, AD, Roy, all you guys at BCSN. We really appreciate what it is that you guys do for us.
production.
Yeah.
I love my HBCU.
And boy,
I love it, love it. Yeah. I love it, love it. Yeah. I love my HBCU.
And man,
I hope my team they won one.
Yeah.
I hope my team they won one.
Yeah. Man,
I hope my team they won one.
Yeah.
I hope my team they won one.
Yeah.
I tune into the HBCU Sports Lab to see if my team won or lost. If they lost, I'm quiet as a mouse. But if they won, keep tab. I'ma do the dab, yeah. Dr. Cavill, he know what he be talking about. Mike and Charles, they know what they be talking about. They compress the analytic data with your hip hop.
If you know them like I know them,
they gon' tell you if your team, if they want a law,
yeah.
And who the ball, who the ball. So listen to Professor, yes sir,
yes sir.
And pay attention, cause he gon' teach a lesson. And you gon' learn today, you gon' learn today, how your team they play,
they play,
how they play, boy, you gon' learn today, how your team
they play,
how they play, play, yeah. We represent that swag, that MEAC, and let me say, what's up to Tennessee, stay, just tune into the HBCU Sports Lab, with Dr. Ville.
This is Dr. Ville with Inside the HBCU Sports Lab with Mike Washington and Charles Bishop. Mike is back on assignment, man. He didn't get ghost. I'm going to have to see what type of recruiting he's doing out there. So it's going to be Charles and I going to hold it up for the team. We do have an interview lined up for you that I hope you'll be prepared to enjoy. As you know, usually on Thursday, we just do our analysis. We're going to give you plenty of analysis, breakdowns of the games coming up this weekend and what took place last weekend in terms of SWAC and HBC football. We'll go inside and outside the numbers, if you would. So welcome to episode 118 of Inside the HBC Sports Lab radio show and podcast, the show that is covering the sporting HBC diaspora, all things HBC sports. For institutions large and small, from NAIA to the NCAA, we share insights and information on the HBC sports culture, HBCU athletic aesthetics to facilitate the story of HBCU athletic programs in the business of HBCU sports. I'm your host, Dr. Kenyatta Cavill, along with my co-hosts, Mike Washington and Charles Bishop. We are filming from our home studio and sending a signal live to KCOH 1230 AM studios with the Texas Radio Hall of Famer, Ralph Cooper, in the beautiful home of Texas Southern University from Houston, Texas. With that, today's episode of Inside HBCU Sports Lab is sponsored by THG Agency. THG Agency is a company that provides sporting and educational consulting and data analytics. With that said, Charles, how are you doing today?
Doing well, Dr. Cavill. You see my special edition, Dr. Cavill, Inside the HBCU Sports Lab hat.
Man, it looks good on you too, man. You wear it. Good, man.
People got to order these. This is nice. I like this.
Yeah, yes, no doubt. And as they don't know, it has a signature on there, Dr. Cavill. And then each one from the team got their special one made for them with the name on it. So it says Charles on yours. It's pretty nice. So it's hard for somebody to grab it, I guess. Well, maybe there's some other Charles out there. So we'll have to make sure that doesn't happen. But with that said, let's get into some HBCU news of the day. From a different perspective, what's going on? That's some good updates that we didn't cover earlier this week.
No doubt. Well, we're going to get into quite a bit of football, of course, but let's start off with some volleyball postseason honors as the SWAC announced their spring 2021 volleyball postseason honors. Arkansas Pine Bluffs Zion Smith was named the Player of the Year, while fellow teammate Haley Gomez claimed the Blocker of the Year recognition. Grambling State's Jada Taylor was tabbed Libero of the Year, and Southern's Princess Stark claimed Setter of the Year accolades. And Alcorn State's Mackenzie Young Mullins was named Newcomer of the Year, and Jackson State's Alexis Williams was tabbed the Freshman of the Year, rounding out the list of SWAC Volleyball Individual Award winners as the SWAC Volleyball Tournament. It gets underway.
Yes, good stuff. SWAC Volleyball, regular season champs with none other than Jackson State University, and they continue, it seems, along with Prairie View, they're going back and forth to see who can stack up those chips. You know, Alabama State gets it done in the track and field, but everything else, You seem like you can portion it off between Jackson State and Prairie View to see who's going to get it done. So it's interesting to see what that's going to be going on. The other thing is obviously the breaking news that just came out the last day or so with Grambling having to go into COVID protocol, which means against Alabama A&M was canceled. And obviously with essentially the 10-day process they go to, you essentially knock out two games. So also the following week of the Grambling game was postponed. So, man, so much going on. It is crazy in so many different ways. What are your thoughts on the cancellation? That's pretty much COVID-19, but, man, I guess your feelings have to go out for Alabama A&M when only being able to get one game in. They can't, and none of them conference games, but, wow, that's just amazing.
Yeah, your heart goes out to Alabama A&M. They've gone through this COVID protocol now. I believe this, is this the third sort of postponement that they've gone through? So it's been a really rough for them to get their, you know, spring season underway. I mean, we only have, you know, one data point with them in terms of that huge win over South Carolina State. And I was really looking forward to watching Alabama A&M get back on the gridiron. But unfortunately, COVID protocols have to take place. So this game was canceled. But, you know, along those same lines, not only Grambling going into COVID protocols, but their starting quarterback, Jeremy Hickman, he entered the transfer portal. So quite a bit going on right now in Grambling.
Yeah, then you got the removal of Grambling State, removes Kendrick Nohr. That seems like old news.
Right, exactly. It just seems...
And that just happened over the weekend. But you just like, wow, it's amazing of just how much is going on in Grambling as they move forward. They did drop the schedule, which is going to be a tough one. But we continue to say that each time a school drops a schedule, we'd be like, oh, look at that schedule. Then obviously you also had the fact that Alcorn State, while they're not playing in spring, they also dropped the schedule. And so you got to look in terms of what's going there. You only have a few left in terms of you finding out exactly what's going to be the nature of the football schedule for the spring. So it'll be interesting to see what's going on there. Before I go back to you, let me give some shout-outs for those that have jumped on here and sharing some love with us, I should say, in regards to the show. Chuck Hunt, Monroe, Louisiana, in the house always, giving us some updates on that Grambling news there. Alan Bozeman says, SWAT team scheduled to play A&M commission. Just sick. We got the COVID. We can't play. Yeah, nobody wants to play Alabama A&M, it seems, right now. As I said the other day, buzz it up. Dwight Moore jumped on here. Good afternoon, professors. Yes, indeed. From the Big D, go Jags. I like it. I like it. Kay Johnson is always in the house sharing us great support. Good evening, Inside the Sports Lab. The Lab Fanatics are here. No doubt about it. I love our Lab Fanatics, boy. They get it done. Reggie Howe, good evening, gentlemen. CIAA in the house, as always. Wendell Davis, brother Wendell Davis, always coming in from Tuscaloosa, checking in from Titletown, USA. Look at that. Arby Parker showing us some love. What's up, Arby? Did a great job with the SWAC tournament. Those night games did a tremendous job getting it done in so many days, in so many ways, I should say. That was nice to see that. I need to hear about A&M will be compensated since Grambling forfeited the weekend. Restitution for the heel. I like that. That's a great point. Karen Griffin is in the house as well. Donald Kofi, Wendy Jenkins Bishop, Jarvis Austin is checking us out. Jerome Jeep Sutton is in here making sure that we get some of the love in terms of our Fanatics for the Lab. Anthony Johnson, TSU has played only one game also. That's very true. No, they actually have played two now. TSU played the Prairie. I know you want to forget about the Prairie View game, but they had that one.
Yeah, they had Prairie View and Southern.
And then they had the Southern, which I certainly know you want to forget about, but I understand. But they hadn't played many, to your point. Fourth cancellation, that's a good point, too. It is the fourth cancellation. Adding up, finding a way to get it done. But that's just what happens when you're in COVID-19. But it's good that the young men are getting a chance to get out there and play. And while some games get getting canceled, the ones that are being played, they are classics.
Yeah, they are.
About different ways. Just giving it, he said, Jerome said, yep, said it well. Tough break for A&M. AD Drew checking us out. And he's behind the scene with the production today. So we want to shout out to him. Appreciate making sure we are taken care of so the fanatics can get in the lab. Chris Tucker, Keith Martin, getting in here, getting it done in so many different ways. Anthony Johnson, Prairie View's best basketball player, entered the transfer portal. Yeah, that was big. Going on there.
Dwan Daniels.
If not the best, certainly one of the best players. But I think that's just the lay of the land. I think you got to understand that if you're going to go out there and try to recruit the best, once they get some of those SWAC accolades, recruiting coaching is taking place, and you just got to go back in there and understand where your lot is. But the thing that's nice about it, because you have elevated yourself to the top of the conference, you are also a destination for transfers coming in. And so it's just the way of the land with the program. Now, some people have a concern about that out there in regards to should you build it with freshmen and then build them through the program. And so some people are concerned about the number of transfers coming into a various program, specifically in terms of HBCU programs and the coaches dealing with that. You have any thoughts in terms of a preferred way that you like to see a team built, or do you understand it's just the time, nature of the time that we're in?
I don't know. I think it's the nature of the time that we're in, because I question from a basketball standpoint whether you can build via the high school route through freshmen anymore. I mean, we've seen sort of the path to the SWAC championship via Texas Southern has been built through kind of the transfer portal. So, as with anything, it becomes sort of a copycat sort of league. So now you see transfers all through the conference and whatnot, because, you know, that has been the blueprint in terms of putting out a winning championship team. So, and then, you know, the second thing that I take a look at is, let's say you do, you know, build through high school or build through trying to bring freshmen in. Well, you run the risk of putting that time and effort into building up, you know, freshmen that could transfer anyway. So it's just sort of the lay of the land.
I didn't think about that. That's right. Now you're talking about really being sick. You go get a freshman, you build them 2 or 3 years. They have a great sophomore, junior year, and they'd be like, I'd like to go see a bigger program.
Yeah.
So that's a big deal. And you got a sharp kid, and the way that you're doing it now, people don't realize is to make sure that programs stay up on the APR. HBCUs have figured that out a lot of ways, and they're getting students to go to summer school, get their credits in. So oftentimes, they're graduating in 3 years.
Yeah.
So then, if you're a graduate, you have the free graduate transfer as well. And so even with that, you could be transferring in 3 years in regards and finishing your eligibility in terms of graduation and wanting to do it with the graduate transfer. So it's something to think about. Belinda Johnson has jumped in here as well. Carl Edmond giving us some love. Lonnie Shaw, the Mighty Aggies. Aggies Lady Track Team coming to Austin for Texas Relays. Yeah, that'll be fun. I hope the Lady Aggies represent and get it done, knowing what they need to do in Austin there for the Texas Relays. Big time event there. Jay Mack is in the house. What's happening, fellas? Yeah, that's our photographer extraordinaire. He gave us some much-needed love with that first game of the year between Alabama State and Southern. He gave us some film on that game. So he always takes care of us and makes sure we give the fanatics, as somebody said earlier in the show. I like that. I don't know if we're going to make that stick. We'll see how that might go. Giving us to make sure that y'all can get the latest and greatest update. With that, before we get into this interview, any other thing that you want to share?
Sure. Let us not forget, it's spring and there's baseball in the air. So I want to give the Black College Nines. They came out with their second poll, if you will, especially for the large schools. Let me give you the top five. Coming in at number five is North Carolina A&T Aggies. They're 7-13 thus far in the season. Number four is Alcorn. They're 5-5 thus far in the season. Alabama State checks in at number three. They were 5-2 in the last poll. BCN poll, current RPI rankings 243. North Carolina Central This being their last year, they come in at number two. They're 10-8 thus far on the season. And number one in the Black College Nines week two poll is Jackson State. They're 11-5 on the season. 5-0 since the last poll ranking. Their current RPI rating is 182. Dropped a midweek game yesterday to Grambling. Kudos to Grambling getting that midweek game against Jackson State.
Oh, man. Grambling jumped up and got Jackson State because Jackson was rolling. Still number one poll ranking and deservedly four. They're playing some really good baseball over there. It's gonna be interesting. Can they chug it through and battle, obviously, the COVID pandemic battles with the protocols? Obviously, it took effect with the Grambling and Prairie View conference matchup, which was going to be the big event in regards to the State Fair Diamond Classic up there in North Dallas, North Texas, in terms of what that looks like. So, unfortunately, they're on the Prairie View side, but Grambling was able to get it in, and so we'll move forward and see what that looks like. As we transition into it a little more, let's talk a little bit about the football. We gave a great tease before we left last week. Want to see what your thoughts are on the polls. Let's see if I can bring that back to you, remind everybody else, just in case it didn't stick with you, Charles, in terms of the poll run. Saw you frowning up, but let's see what that does to you this time. Maybe a day has kind of allowed you to marinate on it a little bit. Receiving votes was Delaware State Hornets, 1-1 on the season. They hadn't been able to play a couple of games, and they were going to play this week, but it got postponed. Now you have South Carolina State, or last week I should say, South Carolina State Bulldogs, 1-1 on the season, as they're preparing for intra matchup, conference matchup, which will be Alabama State and South Carolina State. That'll be a fascinating one in the coming weeks. Alabama State is just outside receiving votes after their big victory over Jackson State. They're 1-1 overall, and obviously that means 1-1 in the conference race. South Carolina State drops out of the poll. South Carolina State Bulldogs, 1-1 on the season. They did bounce back with that win a couple of weeks ago against Delaware State after dropping their opener at home to Alabama A&M. Bringing us to the top five teams in Doctorville's spring 2021 edition of the HBCU Major Division Football Poll Rankings in week number four. With number five, you have Southern, 2-1, overall 2-1 in the conference race. They have a big bounce back win over Texas Southern. And so they have 71 points. They were not ranked, as I said, so they jump in at the five spot. Bringing us to number four, Prairie View A&M Panthers, 2-0. Did not play this week in regards to the COVID protocols. They have one first place vote, remain in the top five, although they drop a spot this week, 80 points overall. Number three, you have Arkansas Pine Bluff at 2-0. Both wins over Grambling and Southern in the Western Division. They have two first place votes, so they took a first place vote. It looks away from Prairie View, 91 points, and they jump up a spot from the previously being ranked four. At number two, you have Jackson State Tigers, 3-1, 2-1, four first place votes, 109 points. They were previously ranked one. They dropped all the way from the number one spot. And with that, they dropped into the two spots. So bringing us number one, Alabama A&M Bulldogs, 1-0 in terms of five first place votes, 110 points. Moving up from the two spot, they take over the number one ranking as they regain it, as they came in the season a couple of weeks ago. Week number two, they were ranked number one until Jackson State got things kicked off and got a couple of victories coming in and everything, so they got it done in some different way. I'm going to put a pin on that and tease you up just a little more. We have our guest coming here, Dr. Hill Ely, more than just a coach. I like that title. He earned that PhD, so I'm going to make sure that the world knows that we got not only a coach here, but we got the academic in terms of getting it done in so many different ways. And so, welcome to the show, Coach. It's good to have you.
Doc, hey, I appreciate you having me.
Man, it's always good to chop it up with you. Before we get into some of the real conversation, at least for a lot of folks, they want to talk about a little bit of football. Can you tell us what you did in terms of your dissertation? What area of study did you decide to do your research in?
My research was factors that influence football student athletes' decisions between the HBCU. So what I wanted to do was find out what were the factors that contributed to student athletes choosing HBCU. So what I ended up doing was a quantitative analysis to really put some statistical background with what are the top three factors that contribute to them choosing us over the predominantly white schools.
Do you mind sharing what those three factors are, a couple of them, really?
Well, you know what? It was kind of funny that one of the first factor was the opportunity to travel. And I found that funny because back in the day, it used to be, I replicated a study by Dr. Corbin from Florida State. And what was funny about it all is that back in the day was a chance to play on TV. Now is a chance to travel. And you will find that a lot of our student athletes don't have, hadn't had a chance to eat at a five-star restaurant or stay at a five-star hotel. So those things were recruitable factors for them. And then the second thing was a chance to play. And then the third thing was to have an opportunity to play on television. So it shows us that with all the equalities and everything that we've been privy to, that the opportunity to play on television was no longer a factor. That was even. The factor now became to an opportunity for exposure, to have an opportunity to stay and eat in well places.
Man, I'm really glad that you shared that with us.
Because thank you.
You know, to get into the debate, I should say, about recruiting players and how you recruit. And a lot of times we get into information that's more with our heart and our head versus, as you said, the research. The other reason I wanted to really ask you about this is my colleague over here, Professor Charles Bishop. Now, he's actually in the doctoral program at Texas Southern University and working on the
doctorate. Good.
So anytime I get to kind of share that and get him excited, I see him over there smiling. It's good that you're able to be versatile. Not only for all our followers out, not only can he talk about the X's and O's and about mentoring students and motivating students, he can tell you about the factors and the academic components behind it. So don't let him fool you out there. That's a brilliant brother right there. With that being said, let's get into it. Let's get into some of these X and O's. You had a great game last weekend against Jackson State. We're able to get out the victory, but I want to actually push forward. I know you've had a lot of questions about that game, but I know your mindset is this on to the next game. So we really want to talk about Pine Bluff. What have you seen since you've been able to get into the film, I'm sure, over the last couple of days? What thing are you noticing about Pine Bluff?
Well, the key is that they're playing together. They're pretty much a replica of ourselves. Pine Bluff ended up finishing middle of the pack on the west side. They had a winning season on their side, better than whatever. And they've been trying to validate themselves. And they start off by beating the number one and the number two team in the west with Southern and Grambling. But I see a team that plays off, they feed off each other. The special teams make plays and then the offense go score. Special team make plays, then the defense go score. So Doc Gamble, you know, was a young man that it's crazy that I recruited when he was coming out of high school, and he became a good friend of mine. And he's a guy that always called me and want to know, coach, what's the best way to do this and what's the best way to do that? But this week I blocked him. I'm not going to call him until Monday. I mean, I've been talking to that man about 20 years, and now I got to block his number because I don't want to talk to him. But it proves, you know, it always good, you know what, to see guys that are treating these young men like men, that is not into all that stuff that goes on, that they're educating guys, getting them ready for the real world. And I know as I look at the tape, you know, you don't see all the unsportsman likes. You see guys that's really playing hard brand of football, that's doing good things. And I'm real proud of him, real proud of what he's been able to do. But come Saturday, I got to find a way to beat him.
Yeah, we had the pleasure to have Doc Gamble on Tuesday, and he shared that with us, that oftentimes y'all call weekly, and enjoys the camaraderie and the relationship he had there. But he said that, he pointed that out. He said, I probably can't call him this week. If I did, he wasn't going to answer it. So But he said, we're going to get it on out of the game, then we can go back to talking. But he talked about that.
That's one week out of the year, I don't want to talk about.
He said, we'll talk about afterwards. Let me share this, Mike, and we'll get back in terms of your team and what you're doing so well on offense and defense. But I want to let Charles come in here and get the chance to ask a follow-up question.
Well, yeah, Coach, I wanted to ask a little bit about sort of the game within the game coming up against UAPB. One of the early, you know, storylines of the season has been Skylar Perry and his play at quarterback for UAPB. But he has a bevy of receivers, Josh Wilkes, Tyron Ralph, and Harry Ballard. Just talk about what you've seen, especially from this receiving core that really has just taken off in the sweat.
Well, you know what? As you look at those guys just making plays, man, and they go on attacking the football. They're really, you know, 50-50 balls. You know, that had always been a big conversation in other places, but you see these guys are catching those balls, man, and the quarterbacks are putting the ball in the right place, and the coordinators are putting the guys in the right place. They're doing stuff where they're running reverse passes. I mean, they just – having fun playing football and making people pay. So,
yeah, so he has to be careful to make sure that he's got the ball where he needs it so he can.
They just have a good core of receivers that make plays and a great group of quarterbacks that rotate in. And then they got a line to protect them. Again, you're going to see two of the same type teams when they take the field on Saturday. I mean, you're going to see a group of guys that are making plays and trying to find a niche on offense. And then on defense, you're going to see guys that just fly around and make great decisions and score points. So, you know, this is going to be a real balanced contest.
So take us inside the locker room. I know you can't tell us the secrets. I know you can't give us the play. We understand that. And we would not really understand X's and O's. Said it anyway. Many of us would like to think so, but you know, that's because we those couch coaches, as they like to say. But with that being said, what are some key factors that you are wanting to get done so the Hornets can get off the field with the victory?
You know what? The key we got to do, you know, we've beat an Alcorn and came back the next week and lost. We beat a Grambling, came back the next week and lost. We just got to be for real, you know, and that's what I'm telling the players, you know, are you for real? You know, can you replay what you just did the week before, or are you cinder fellas? Are you guys that just show up and all of a sudden at 12 o'clock after the big game is over with? And that's the thing I've been challenging them with, is that can you do this week in and week out, go out and perform and replicate the performance that you had the week before? So that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to replicate. We want to be able to replicate the performance we had against Jackson. If we're able to do that, we'll be in the championship game.
I like that. You're talking about that consistency week to week of playing at a high level because the talent is there. But with young folks that hadn't quite had the consistent winning, a lot of times they don't really understand that. And so you have to ingrain that in them over a period of time. So I can see where that's coming from. Charles, you want to jump in here with a follow-up question?
Yeah, and I wanted to ask a little bit about your defense, Coach, in terms of you guys really had a game plan that really took Jackson State out of what they wanted to do, especially in the first half last week, and not allowing a ground game to get up and going. But talk about your front seven. I mean, you have some individuals who really plug things up in the middle, and a linebacker who's a real thumper.
Well, you know what? We got two 300-pounders, 340-pounders in the middle with Brandon Gaddy and Kristen Clark, and our linebacker has been able to slide free and make a lot of plays. And Bubba Adams has been averaging about 14 play tackles a game. And what we want to do defensively is to get guys running east and west to really slow them down from going north and south to the goal line. That's with the running game. And with the passing game, we want to attack the deep ball, you know, deep ball down. And we've been able to do that. And these guys have been flying around, and we've had guys hurt and still have guys that come in from two deep and three deep and really make plays. I've just been impressed with these guys playing in the spring. Guys have just been stepping up and trying to make plays.
No doubt about it, Coach. One final question we have, because I know your schedule is busy before we allow you to get out of here. Anything you wanted to share with the Alabama State Hornets, the faithful that have been supporting you from day one?
Well, you know what? I'm the 29th head coach here, man, and it's one of those situations where year in and year out, you know, you're on a one-year contract and you're trying to put stuff together. Is, you know, do a true assessment of what we're doing here at the program. We got freshmen and sophomores playing. We're not in the transfer portal getting 25 and 30 cats. You have a true opportunity of having a program. And so many times I think our folks get so caught up into immediate that they don't understand what's going to sustain this program is the longevity of having people here to put things together over the period of time. So that's always my quest, is that look at it with a true eye, that it ain't about today, it's about tomorrow. And that what we going to put on the field tomorrow with four redshirt freshmen on a sophomore on the offensive line, two redshirt freshmen in the secondary, two redshirt freshmen at the linebacker, at the D line, at the running back position. The future is bright.
Yeah.
Just hold on.
Yeah. As they say, you ain't seen
as the old slave song say, hold on a little while long.
Yes, sir.
Everything will be all right.
Fellas, they ain't seen nothing yet. They just need to let the track roll.
Hold on just a little while long.
Yes, sir. With that, I know you got work to do, and we don't want to hold you up, but certainly want to say thank you for taking out some of your time and giving us a great interview.
Oh, yeah. Say that one more time.
Yeah, I was just saying we wanted to appreciate you giving up your time. I know that you have to get back to it. We just want to say thank you. Continue great work that you're doing. And formally wanted to say congratulations as you finish your PhD. Congratulations on the win, and just congratulations on how you're building the young men in character.
Well, Doc, I appreciate it, man. I tell you, one of the best moments I had in my life was defending my dissertation and they saying, okay, you complete. And when I walked forward, Doc, I was like, I did all of this for what? And now when they be saying Dr. Illy, I'll be looking around like, who the hell are they talking to?
Yeah, that's real talk.
Yes,
talk.
Sir.
I know how that feels. Man, it's always good to chop it up with you. Keep it getting to hear from you before the end of the season and to get you back on to talk a little bit more about your program. Keep it a great
one. All right, Doc. Thank you all so much.
No problem.
Thank you, Coach.
That's Dr. Bills inside HBCU Sports Lab with Mike Washington, Charles Bishop. That's Coach Dr. Hill Ely giving you insight about Alabama State program, the victory they had last week against Jackson State, and the upcoming big game against Arkansas, Pine Bluff. Pine Bluff comes in undefeated. Both of them coming off playing great games, playing good football. So it'll be interesting. Somebody's going to get a little edge in the divisional countdown as they seek to try to get in the championship. And while some people may not see it like this, is this a prelude to what will be the championship game? Will it be back in Montgomery? Will it be in Arkansas in terms of Pine Bluff, as they say up in that way? Or will it be somebody else? You stay tuned to us, and we'll chop it up and talk a little more football on the other side. This is Dr. Bill inside the HBCU Sports Lab with Mike Washington, Charles Bishop. Do not change that dial. Stick with us. We'll be right back after this break.
A.D. Drew and I are co-hosts of the BCSN Sports Wrap. We talk about all things related to HBCU athletics. From the games, teams, coaches, and fan interest stories, we cover it all. You can find our shows on Facebook at BCSN Sports Wrap, YouTube at MyJBN Online, and everywhere you listen to podcasts like Anchor, Spotify, Google, and Apple Podcasts. You can also find the show on the Jericho Broadcast Network's app. Make sure to download. We look forward to you joining the conversation and being a part of the show. Support the Black College Sports Network so we can continue to provide you coverage. Go to myjbn.com/support and be a part of the Black College Sports. Tell everybody they can follow their dreams.
Yeah, it is.
This is Dr. Ville with Inside the HBCU Sports Lab with Mike Watson and Charles Bishop. Charles is just telling you, yeah, it is. He's telling you. Let's see what he said about the poll. Let me give you one quick update again, just for y'all to jump in here. I'll be fast with this. At number five, Southern Jaguars, 2-1 overall. Prairie View at number four, 2-0 overall. At number three, Arkansas Pine Bluff, 2-0 overall. Number two is Jackson State, 3-1 overall. And number one is Alabama A&M, the Bulldogs. 1-0 overall, only playing one game, but they're number one in the poll ranking. Charles, what you say? It's your chance. You've been chopping it up for 2 days to get at me.
So the question becomes, can Alabama A&M get a couple games in? That becomes a question because they're a linchpin sitting out there for a lot of teams watching. I was like, okay. is the clock going to run out on Alabama A&M getting some games in? I tell you, the early storyline of the season has been UAPB, and I jokingly said with Doc Gamble the other day, they are the Louisiana State champions with the wins over Southern and Grambling. I think that's the first time since 2012 that that's happened. But they're just, you know, Dr. Hill-Lilly, he touched on it. They're just playing great ball. Guys flying around all over the place. You have a great – receiving trio with Josh Wilkes, Tyron Ralph, and Harry Ballard. Skylar Perry is one of the better quarterbacks in the league. He's improved tremendously. And this matchup with Alabama State, I tell you what, I watched that defensive line up close last week against Jackson State. They are the truth. When he mentions they have 240-pound guys plugging things up in the middle, that frees up the linebackers, and the linebackers are some bumpers. It will be a very interesting matchup when you have Pine Bluff receivers going against Alabama State secondary. Let's see what happens. That's the game within the game that I'm really looking forward to watching. And, you know, Alabama State's offensive line, you know, they've opened up holes. They found some creases for Ezra Gray in the fourth quarter. You know, let's see if they wear you down. And he mentioned you got four – you know, redshirt freshman and a redshirt sophomore. You got a redshirt freshman quarterback. You know, the future is really bright for Alabama State. Like Prime says, you better get Jackson State now. You better get Alabama State now.
Yeah, I like where how you thinking there. Talking about Michael over there, wide receiver for Alabama State, and how he stacks up against that defense and the cornerback play at Arkansas Pine Bluff. Go a little more inside that number in terms of this side, because most people are looking at Arkansas Pine Bluff with the trio and the depth they have in terms of those receivers of Pine Bluff against a freshman, young cornerback tandem of Alabama State. Go on both sides of the ball before we take down in regards to those games that were canceled. But go inside a little more about these numbers. Take me inside to what are your thoughts from the offensive matchup, the wide receiver play from Alabama State versus the defensive cornerback play, if you would, Arkansas Pine Bluff, and then vice versa.
Well, I think with Alabama State, you have two really good receivers, Jahad Booker and Michael Johnson. Michael Johnson is a serious deep threat, and he's one of those guys that I think you're going to see playing on Sundays. It is a very interesting matchup going against this Arkansas Pine Bluff secondary that, you know, we haven't talked a lot about them, but they have a couple guys, Jalen Pigpen and Keaton Johnson. Both of them, they have interceptions thus far on the season. Jalen Pigpen, if I'm not mistaken, he leads the league. I think he has two picks already on the season. So, and he brought one back last week against Ramble for a touchdown. So that's going to be a really interesting matchup to see, number one, if Alabama State has the time to get the ball downfield to Michael Jefferson, because I still haven't seen the breakout game from Michael Jefferson, but he was one of the top deep threats in the league when we last saw Alabama State play in 2019.
Also, when you talk about oftentimes, so you can set up the pass play, you got to be able to run the ball. We saw what Ezra Gray was able to do against Jackson State. It played some pretty good defense, and a lot of people like the linebackers of Jackson State. So the fact that they were able to make plays as they were trying to stuff the run and get in there and snuck and took off on some big runs, Pine Bluff is playing really well, as you just said, from a linebacker position. The question I have for you when you break this down, can Alabama State, can Ezra Gray, with the offensive line that they have, can they run the ball against Pine?
Yes, they can. I don't think anybody can stop Ezra Gray. He's proved that time in, time out, in terms of being an all-SWAC performer. He's a guy who gets it done. And like my old football coach used to say, he can fall for 4 yards. And that's just what he does. I don't know if you saw, but did you see the breakaway speed? Once he gets past the initial wall, he's gone. You know, so that was one of the things that really caught my eye with Ezra Gray. And then the other thing about him is he can get it done in special teams, too. You can't kick out to him because he'll break you there, too. So this is going to be a really good matchup with Alabama State and Pine Bluff. Who would have thunk that those would be the two teams that everybody would have their eyes on this weekend?
Yeah, so keys to victory. Since this is essentially our big matchup, we'll get into a little bit of Tennessee State. They had a tough loss. So we'll break that down next since this our other game that's on since – obviously, the Alabama A&M Grambling game was canceled. And then we can get into some particulars about what do we think, how that's going to play out the rest of the season and the psychological factor of not being to play in those games. We've seen it in basketball in Prairie View for a team that had a break. In Jackson State, another team that had a break, they were able to fight through it. They went through the season undefeated and still got it done. So maybe we can get into the psychological framework. Especially coming up next week, we're going to get into some health conversations in regards to player athletes and COVID-19 for a special edition next week. So I want to kind of end with that in mind. But again, looking at this matchup, top three thing and why has to happen for each of these teams to be successful.
The first thing that I'm looking for in this game is, can Alabama State get to Skylar Perry? That's the number one thing. They did a tremendous job of getting to Jalen Jones last week. He had some big plays, but he got hit a lot in that game. And I was very impressed by the way Alabama State, they blitzed him. They really came after him. They didn't let him get comfortable in the pocket. He was only 19 of 50. And I don't think you ever want Jalen Jones to pass the ball 50 times. But, you know, to their credit, they made Jackson State pretty one-dimensional in that first half, only 20 yards of rushing. So the question becomes, can Alabama State, can their front seven get to Skylar Perry and keep that passing game from getting rolling? Flip side of that, can Arkansas Pine Bluff slow down Ezra Gray? I think that's going to be another storyline that everybody's going to keep an eye on with regards to can Alabama State run the ball. Coach Hill Ely talked about, you know, are they contenders or pretenders? You know, they have this huge game against Jackson State, and they, you know, you're curious to see if they level off the following week. So I think that's another something that, you know, you have to keep an eye on, which Alabama State team are we actually going to see. So those are the three things that I'm really curious about in terms of the factors in this game with Arkansas Pine Bluff, Alabama State going on the road. So this is a true pick'em in terms of who's going to win this ball game, but I like Arkansas Pine Bluff.
Great pick. You say it's a close one, but you're going to go with Pine Bluff. They're rolling so many different ways. Well, let's jump over here to Tennessee State. They're a pass matchup. They'll take on UT Martin, University of Tennessee Martin this week, who is 2-2 on the season, while Tennessee State is just 1-3. They dropped 0-2 in the conference race, and part of that was the loss to Murray State. But I want to give you these factors and see if you can tell me what the score is. You probably have done your homework. But with that said, maybe this is more for our listeners that may have not gotten a score. Tennessee State put up 362 yards. Murray State had just 343 yards. Passing-wise, 202 for Tennessee State, 156 for Murray State. Rushing was 160 yards. For Tennessee State. Murray just had 188 yards. First downs was 20-20. 6-14 third down efficiency for Murray State, 5-10. Penalties, 13 of 90, 6 of 65. Not too far out of whack, a little bit something there. Each had a turnover. Time of possession was close. The score of the game was Murray State 35, Tennessee State 13. why did you get such a lopsided score when you go into the numbers in terms of this matchup versus the score? Any thoughts to you inside of that?
It's frustrating sometimes watching because this is another game where I've seen them kind of wear down in the second half. Things were right there, you know, within their grasp. It's 14 to 10, I believe, at halftime. And the big thing was Devon Starling. He had got up and running for Tennessee State. So I hadn't seen the rushing game and that big offensive line, like, lay down on you until this game against Murray State. And they just flat ran out of gas in the second half. Just too many possessions where they weren't able to do anything. And it just took one touchdown. And with Murray State there in the third quarter, and it just kind of opened the floodgates. And fourth quarter, Tennessee State was completely flat. So I have not seen them play four full quarters of football where they're in it from beginning to end. So, and it's very frustrating because I see talent. You know, I see quite a bit of talent. Isaiah Green, I think they solidified the quarterback position. I was wondering about that as we started the season with them. The running game got on track, but they still haven't been able to get stops yet.
Yeah, the other thing that frustrated me about this game is Tennessee State, as you see by the numbers, they were able to move up and down the field. The first drive, they took it right down the field, down their throat, got into the red zone, really into the green zone, some people like to call it, inside the 10, and then they got the penalty bugs.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
And had to settle for a field goal, and they weren't able to get the field goal. The snap didn't get off. So you led what should have been a touchdown because they were literally in the green zone, went down the field, and penalties took them out of it, and then they don't get 3 points at least. Next time they come down the field, they do the same thing after they stop Murray State on their first drive. They go back down the field, and the same thing happens. They get red zone, green zone, stop. This time they do get the field goal. So you essentially leave, 10, 12, 14 points overall on the table, right? And then Murray State gets it together and scores and start pulling around. Then late in the second half, they get into the green zone, red zone again. Yeah. They get timed and can't get it done and have to settle for a field goal. They did make this one. And so you really look at it, they had 5 scoring possessions. So essentially, if they can get in the end zone, you're talking about a 35-35 game in a lot of ways in terms of your opportunities. You're talking about a whole different game in terms of how your team is feeling, the pressure you put on Murray State. Do they even score the last time? Because now they're calling differently. But that's the other thing, and one of the reasons I wanted to point out the matchup and the numbers going inside the numbers and tell you really how close this game was in terms of how they were able to play, which gets back to your point. If I'm a Tennessee State fan, I am frustrated in a lot of ways because while we joke and say, they may overhype themselves with the talent, in terms of what you're seeing now, at least in terms of Murray, that's 4-0, I think they are going to ultimately the second best team in the conference. Yeah. I think Jacksonville is the best, but they played right with Jacksonville to give you another example where they left some points on the table. But in this game, they were right there in terms of showing you what they could do. So they had to frustrate so many different ways.
Eerily similar to another TSU team in terms of this Tennessee State game, because like you said, they bulldogged their way right down the field and they got in the, green zone and they started, with the six shooter, Yosemite Sam. They started shooting themselves in the foot. And it's just very frustrating to watch that kind of football because when you see the talent and it's the mental errors, that kind of take them out of scoring position. So it's just a tough game for Tennessee State, 1-3 thus far, but still a talented team.
Oh, man, it's so true when you just talk about it. Well, before we get into their next matchup against UT Martin, I should say, I did want to get this update, and we'll give it to you again. Coming up after Inside HBCU Sports Lab on Black College Sports Network, stay in for the doubleheader. You'll have Facebook and YouTube Live. You can check in BCSN Sports Wrap with Brian and AD as they have a special guest with Prentice Hill and Jamie Walker of Coach Work Media. Also on BCS Sports Wrap page on Facebook. You can get that right after this show. Jump back into it. I want you to talk about this UT Martin matchup with Tennessee State. Can they get off the snide UT Martin is 2-2 on the season, so they're playing decent football. Tennessee State, as we told you, 1-3 in terms of the previous matchups. When you look at the teams that play, they have got it done against Martin a couple of times, but UT Martin is getting better. Martin is 2-3 in their last five games, including from the previous season back in 2019, with the last game they lost at the end of the season at University of Kentucky, when you go back that far. You also have Tennessee State coming in at 2-3 on their last five games, including the tough loss we just talked about to Murray State. What are your thoughts in terms of UT Martin and Tennessee State?
I tell you what, if I don't think I want to go 1-4 if I'm Tennessee State. Backs against the wall, you better get this win this weekend. You have the talent. And, you know, I would lean on that running game because Bob Strong was really chewing Murray State up and really use those big matches that they have up front and get this win because Tennessee State fans, you know, you can't keep stacking up these losses even in the spring before, you know, everybody kind of starts turning around and looking and kind of trying to figure out what's going on with their beloved Tennessee State program. So Tennessee State needs to get the win this weekend.
I think you got a great point when you say that, and it's well said about them needing to get their win in so many different ways. And while you look at Grambling State, they're struggling a little bit. Last championship, or at least playoff bid, when they were finished in the top part of the conference for the OVC, he doesn't have a championship like Grambling State.
Yeah. So,
in terms of what's going on there. So you're right. People are getting a little concerned about what's going on there. So it'll be fascinating in terms of what's going on. But let me go inside this now. What about these teams that are having to take these COVID-19 breaks? How are you thinking that's affecting them in regards to how they should handle that moving forward in so many different ways? What are your thoughts on that?
I take my hats number one off to all these coaching staffs and these student athletes for continuing to forge forward during a pandemic. It's got to be pretty difficult to practice, and kind of get yourself mentally prepped and, you know, to for the COVID protocols to kick in when you have something like this happen. So mentally, it has to take a toll. You know, I can only imagine what Alabama A&M is going through right now because, you know, there's an outpouring of wanting to watch them play, but they have had to, unfortunately, had to sort of deal with the reality of what we live in right now. So it's difficult in terms of how you move forward from there. Yeah, I kind of share a little bit of Connell Maynard's frustration. You know, he's emptied his bag of tricks, as he said, in terms of trying to motivate his team. So I can't imagine what it would be like to coach during a time like this.
Yeah, you referenced in that interview he had with Mo Carter up there on who guest was us a couple of weeks ago, giving us some love in terms of showing out for us. But he had a great interview, and you're right, you could hear it. He's like, man, I don't know what else to say. You know, we're just going to work through it and muscle through it. Great point. Somebody asked a question about Alabama State, Arkansas Pine Bluff. Would it be on TV? Yes. It's on ESPN3. That is a evening game under the lights, 7:00 p.m. Central kickoff. So anyways, it'll be interesting. I guess the other question wanted to get in a little bit in terms of the baseball as we close out, as you share some love. Any big-time matchups in baseball you think we ought to look out for? Obviously, we got the big game with Southern and Pine Bluff up in Frisco in terms of the classic that Prentice is going on. And stick with us, and you can get a little more information in terms of following the show with BCSN and Sports Wrap with Brian and AD to go inside that to give you some real insight what's going on. But what are your thoughts about some of the baseball as we give some love in that direction?
Jackson State is beating the cover off the ball right now. This is probably one of the most exciting offensive teams that I've seen from Jackson State in quite some time. The question always is, do they have the arms to match the bats? We know they can get the ball, but they are really tearing the cover off the ball right now. Should be a really good, interesting weekend matchup with Alabama A&M. Also looking forward to, let's see if Southern can carry forward some momentum from that big win, that Sunday win against Rice this past weekend, going playing UAPB this weekend. So got some good matchups going into the weekend, and, you know, take my hat off, Grambling. They get that midweek win against Jackson State. Jackson State, number one team, according to Black College 9. So let's see if Grambling can get something rolling this weekend as well.
Yeah, it'll be interesting in terms of those matchups. And just want to shout out for some of the folks that joined us today. And as Anthony Weston said, psychologically, it has to be tough. I agree. George Walker, James Knox, Belinda Johnson, John Jenkins, shout out to y'all showing us much love. Really appreciate all those that have chimed in over the show. Harvey Parker is really getting it in. Those tummies don't hurt. Come on to the hill. Let us play. Yeah, we want to play. We want to play. They want to play.
We want to see you. We want to see you.
I've been
waiting to watch Alabama A&M all season.
Well, check us out. We'll be on here Sunday to chop it up to give you some updates after that game, and we'll break down the Arkansas Pine Bluff Alabama State game. It should be interesting, one for the books. With that, we'll do it for the show today. Thank you for listening to Inside HBCU Sports Lab. Make sure you share our podcast with your friends and colleagues. I am Dr. Kenyatta Cavill, the Dean of HBCU Sports, with Mike Washington and Charles Bishop. Again, Mike Washington is on assignment, but stick with us. We hope you enjoyed our interview with Coach Dr. Hill Ely. That's Dr. Donald Hill Ely, getting it done as the head football coach at Alabama State, sharing you some insight about the program and a little bit about his research. Again, we want to thank you for listening to Dr. Hill's Inside the HBCU Sports Lab with Mike Washington and Charles Bishop every Tuesday and Thursday at 6 o'clock. We look forward to next week and as we discuss the latest news in the lab. Follow me, Dr. Kenyatta Cavill, on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. That's DrKenyattaCavill on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Dream big and continue to move forward. We will talk with you soon. Charles?
Horse.
Lecture.
Dismissed.
YT Productions.
Yeah. I love my HBCU.
And boy,
I love it, love it. Yeah. I love it, love it. Yeah. Yeah. I love my HBCU.
And man,
I hope my team they won one.
Yeah.
I hope my team they won one.
Yeah. Man.
I hope my team they won one.
Yeah.
I hope my team they won one.
Yeah.
I tune into the HBCU Sports Lab to see if my team won or lost. If they lost, I'm quiet as a mouse. But if they won, keep tab. I'ma do the dab, yeah. Dr. Cavill, he know what he be talking about. Mike and Charles, they know what they be talking about. They compress the analytic data with the hip hop.
If you know them like I know them,
they gon' tell you if your team, if they won or lost. And who the ball, who the ball.
So listen to Professor, yes sir,
yes sir.
And pay attention, cause he gon' teach a lesson.
And you gon' learn today, you gon' learn today, how your team they play, how they play, boy, you gon' learn today, how your team they play, how they play, yeah.
We represent that swag, that MEAC, and let me say, what's up to Tennessee State?